This week on Dig Me Out. With your hosts, Jason Zia and Tim Minichi.
Jay, we're back again with another episode thanks to our Dig Me Out Union on Patreon. You can help us make the next episode happen by joining us at dmounion.com or digmeoutunion.com. Jay, speaking of said union, got a union member joining us for this episode. He's back.
Let's hear it. He's back.
He's back. And here are his previous picks. Let's see what the through line is, if there is one.
Straight out of Kingston.
Exactly. 2021, we had The Age of Electrics, Make a Pest a Pet.
Okay.
2022, Face to Face, Ignorance is Bliss.
I can see those two going together.
Okay. 2023, Holly McNarland, Stuff. That was just last year, Jay.
That's a little different.
Yeah. So let's introduce our guest for this episode. He comes back with these in his vault. What has he broken out from the collection for us to revisit this time? Welcome back to the show, Darren Lehman. Darren, how you doing?
I'm doing great, guys. Thanks for having me.
What do you have for us for this episode? What's the album you picked?
The album I picked is Finger 11 Tip from 1997.
Jay, this is an album that has appeared in a poll. I am sure
it has. Yep. Yeah. Yes, at least once, maybe twice.
And yet, no idea what they sounded like before going into this. Were you familiar with Finger 11 at all?
I remember the band name, and I associated them with like that new metal adjacent modern rock sound of the early 2000s. I didn't know they were a 90s band. I thought of the band as a 2000s band.
Okay. Yeah.
That's all I knew.
So, Darren, is this a band that you got into when their first record came out? And actually, first record is a little bit of a misnomer because we'll get into it, but this is their first under this name, but they actually put out a record before this. When did you get into this band?
So I would have got into them in, I want to say, 97. So
okay.
The album came out in Canada in 97, and it was under Mercury Records, and then they got dropped, and then I think it was Wind Up Records that picked them up, and then it was re-released again in 98. Before that, they were called the Rainbow Butt Monkeys. And
ouch.
Yeah. I don't know. So, and their first album, I think it's called Letters to Shutney or Shoot Me or something like that. And it came out in 95. Yeah, I actually have it on CD, and I didn't get it until the last few years, actually, believe it or not. And it's very, very different than this album. It's very like funk rock, funk metal, funk alternative is probably the best way to put it. So they took a pretty big left turn when they changed their name and released Tip.
Wasn't that the name of Barry's band in High Fidelity?
It might have been, to be honest.
Sonic Death Monkey. Yeah.
We used to be called Sonic Death Monkey. Now we're called Barry Jive and the Uptown Five.
Wasn't there a Catherine Turner Overdrive in there too?
Oh, there was a Catherine Turner Overdrive. What was the name of?
And then we changed it to Finger 11.
And then what was the name of? There was the name of the kids who had the cassette.
Something about wheelchairs.
Yeah, I can't remember. Oh, okay. So let's get into this record and talk about their history.
History of the band.
The band is from Burlington, Ontario. How far is that from Kingston?
So it's in the greater Toronto area. It's a suburb of Toronto. Yeah. So about
is it
probably three and a half hours.
Is it the home of the Burlington Coat Factory? Is that where that originates?
I think Vermont.
I've heard of that, but I don't know.
Okay. I was unsure. I thought I'd ask. So as you mentioned, they actually started out, well, the original name of the band, it gets worse going back. Soul Picnic was the first name of the band in 1990. Yeah. They quickly changed that.
Ooh.
Now, to be fair, they were high school. They were at Lester B. Yes. Pearson High School.
Yeah. And all right.
So that's the kind of thing, you're sitting around the table at lunch.
Yeah.
And you're like, what are we going to call our bands, dude? you know what? Stone Soul Picnic. How deep is that? That sounds deep. And you're like, yeah, I'm going to go get another, piece of pizza, and then I'll be back and we can discuss that. So yeah, they played their first shows at school, and they ended up winning a rock search competition. Now, at the time, the lineup of the band, and it's been three main members, and they've had a couple different drummers.
Yeah.
Scott Anderson on lead vocals, James Black on lead guitar and backing vocals, Rick Jacket on bass, rhythm guitar, and Sean Anderson on bass. And then at the time, Rob Gomerman was the drummer. He left after this record that we're going to talk about, and Rich Beto took over. He was the drummer from about 98 until 2014. And then Steve Molella, I think that's how you say it, M-O-L-E-L-L-A. He took over for drums, the drumming seat in 2014, and has been there the entire time. And they have basically been together the entire time. They've been active in some way, shape, or form. Now, you mentioned it. They had a quick change from Stone Soul Picnic to Rainbow Butt Monkeys. That was their name up until 97. They did release an album as Rainbow Butt Monkeys, called Letters from Chutney. It was released on Mercury Records. It wasn't on some indie. They were on Mercury Records. And they changed the name because, let's be quite honest, nobody's going to take you seriously if your band's called Rainbow Butt Monkeys. So they changed it to Finger 11. Second album of the band, first under that name, Tip, comes out in August of 1997. It doesn't do well, and after 6 weeks, Mercury drops them.
Oh, my goodness.
They didn't even make it 2 months.
Wow. That's brutal.
Yes.
Brutal.
They got dropped real, real quick. But Wind Up Records, which was, if people might remember, was the home of Creed. And Creed, they had opened for Creed, swoops in and says, hey, we're gonna sign you guys, and we'd like to re-release the record, which they did. The following year, they re-released the album by Wind Up. And, okay, we didn't have this discussion ahead of time. There is a difference between the Canadian version and the Wind Up version.
Oh, yeah. Boy.
So yeah. The streaming one that I listen to is the Wind Up version.
Okay.
How do you know that?
Because I compared the song titles in Wikipedia.
Mm-hmm.
Between the two versions. And I didn't realize it until I went to look at Wikipedia today that there were two different versions. So the main difference is, on the Mercury release, the original release, track 4 is a song called Consolation Day. And on the Wind Up release, it's Awake and Dreaming.
Oh, yeah.
So which one did you listen to, Jay?
The one with Awake and Dreaming?
Yeah,
funny because mine says the release date is 98 and the company is the Bicycle Music Company.
Yeah, I think they might have re-released it or something.
Okay.
Because that's what it says in where I'm looking. And then, Darren, which version are you listening to? Or did you listen to?
So I have the Mercury version on CD. I think I got it through CD Club, actually, BMG or something. And then, so I knew that track 4 was called Consolation Day, but then I started streaming it on Apple iTunes, and it was called Awake and Dreaming. And so I was kind of like, what?
Oh, so did they just change the name of the song? Is it the same? Or is it a different song?
It's the exact same song. So the words Awake and Dreaming are in the chorus.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's actually, the song's actually called Consolation Day. And then the chorus, Awake and Dreaming, is the two of the words that are in the chorus. So they just, I don't know why, but they changed, retitled it Awake and Dreaming, but it's the exact same song.
And it's somehow like 25 seconds shorter.
Yeah.
That's weird. So essentially it's the same record. They just trimmed some of that. They must have remixed that song.
Yeah.
It was produced by Arnold Lanni, who was formerly a member of the band Sheriff, who had the hit single power ballad When I'm With You. You might remember the sweet, sweet sounds of Sheriff. He also produced bands such as Our Lady Peace, The Guffs, and King's X Ear Candy, which we talked about.
Nice.
It's always, I mean, if we were to build some sort of web with string on a board, we would be connecting so many things from this podcast.
Yeah.
And then Howie Weinberg mastered it, which is, Howie Weinberg has probably mastered half the albums we've talked about. He was very busy in the 90s. I don't even know what happens in mastering. It seems like a mysterious event.
you just put the compression on it.
Is that all you do? You just press a button, compression,
pretty
done,
much.
Mastered, give me my check?
I think so, pretty much. You're just figuring out how much to compress it.
Yeah, I think they keep it mysterious so we don't know how much they're actually doing.
And modern mastering is even less thought out than old mastering because they're just like, just brick wall the whole thing. Just turn the compression up so it's loud.
So the band, after this, continued with Wind Up Records and continued to work with Arnold Lanni for their follow-up, 2000's The Grayest of Blue Skies. Then, in 2003, they released the self-titled album. That was produced by Johnny Kay. Johnny Kay had some quite interesting... he worked on Tweaked and Peach Fuzz by Enough's Enough and Seven. He worked with Disturbed, Machine Head, Three Doors Down, Drowning Pool, Megadeth, Stained, Pop Evil. Quite the he's got a big discography. Yep. That was followed by Them Versus You Versus Me, also produced by Johnny Kay, also released by Wind Up Records. That came out in March of 2007. In 2010, they released the album Life Turns Electric. That was also on Wind Up. That was produced by the band. And then you have their, I think, final studio album as of right now, which is Five Crooked Lines. And that was released on the, as mentioned, the Bicycle Music Company. I'm going to guess that's their own imprint, maybe, or label, since the re-released or the streaming stuff is with that same name. So maybe that's like their company or something. And then last year they released a Greatest Hits. So I don't know in terms of, do you know anything about, are they still active in terms of touring, Darren, or playing shows, or what's the deal?
Yes, they are. Yeah. So just a note on the Bicycle Music Company, they bought Wind Up. They bought Wind Up's back catalog. They bought their back catalog. So,
oh, okay.
That's why. But yeah, so Finger 11 is still active. And they're still touring. I don't think they're touring as much as they used to. They all have kids now. The lead singer was the last one to have kids. I just watched an interview with them the other day. And they released a Greatest Hits album, I think, within the last year and a bit. So I find that I see with touring, I kind of sort of checked in on their website a little bit, that they seem to do more in the summer and do festivals and stuff like that. So yeah, but no, they haven't made an album since 2015.
And the Greatest Hits did include, I guess, one new track, which the band did a video for and everything. And they've been nominated for a number of Juno Awards and Much Music Awards. They won for like Best Video. They won for an award for 500,000 Spins. They won an award Rock Album of the Year. in 2008 for Them Versus You Versus Me, and Paralyzer won an award for the number of plays. So I don't know in terms of like album sales how things have gone, but I'm guessing based on their continued touring and their success with awards and stuff like that, that they've probably done okay in terms of album sales, especially in Canada. Probably, I don't know what I guess it'd be gold. I don't know what gold is in Canada in terms of how many you have to sell.
I should know that, but it's not as many as you think.
Well, in the U.S. it'd be half a mil. So
it's definitely less than that here.
Their self-titled album that came out in 2003 went gold in the U.S.
And it
went to number 96 on the U.S. chart. Now it went to number 4 on the Canadian chart. What's interesting is the follow-up record then also charted, went to number 31 and went gold, and that went number 2 in Canada. So they're two, in terms of sales and in terms of chart position, the two best charting and sales albums have been the self-titled and Them Versus You Versus Me, which were 2003 and 2007. And they've had a number of singles that have charted. Apparently, Paralyzer went to number 1 in the U.S. on the U.S. alternative chart and the U.S. mainstream chart. I did not know that. Went to number 1 in Canadian rock charts. So
yeah, it was bigger.
No idea. Out of it.
That, honestly, 2007, completely unaware of what's going on the radio at that point.
Just
out of touch. That would have been, if back in 2007, I'm guessing that this band was probably played on the hard rock station that would play your like new metal, that would play your Creeds and Linkin Parks and those kind of bands. And 99.7 The Blitz is what it's called here in Columbus. And I did not tune into that station that often.
Well, that's peak iPod in the first year that I found. So by that point, I got my own radio station in my pocket.
Exactly. Yeah, I got my 600 kilobytes of songs on my first iPod with my little dial. So
on Them Versus You Versus Me, they had some like crossover success because they had a couple big ballads and they actually got picked to play on that show Live from Daryl's House with Daryl Hall.
Oh,
yeah. Two of the guitar players actually went and did I'll Keep Your Memory Bag, Talking to the Walls Again. They did Paralyzer and they did Falling On. They did four of their songs with his band, and they did four other songs. I've seen the episode. It's actually quite good, and they're very self-deprecating. They're like, you know, we're just a pair of rock guitarists, and these guys are like real musicians, and they do this for a living. It's kind of embarrassing for us, like, you know. But no, it's good. It's good. They did well.
Well, Living in a Dream was the 2011 WWE Royal Rumble theme song. So that's pretty much the pinnacle right there. You're not going to get much better than the WWE Royal Rumble theme song.
Oh, I think it gets better. It's Slow Chemical, which was Kane the Wrestler's theme music that they did. Yeah.
So these guys are set for life. You got Kane money.
I think so.
You're good for several generations. Those kids that they got are going to be set up. Let's get into...
They probably made more money than Kane made.
Honestly, you're probably... Yeah, McMahon probably shafted Kane.
Right. Yeah. McMahon can't touch the royalties there on the music.
No. Let's get over to some comments over at Patreon. We'll share the poll results at the end of the show. Jeremy Amend said, "What were they the first word number band of the seemingly endless stream of word number bands in the 90s? I can't recall. No, there were a lot of new word number bands before this. I mean, I guess 7 Mary 3 is two words and a number. Third Eye Blind is a number and two words. Blink 182. There's a lot. Gavin said I've worked hard over the years to create a cool, discerning music lover algorithm on the net. Some of these recent suggestions are putting that in jeopardy. Derivative single. Sorry. Adam Rogan said, I bought this CD after seeing the video for Above, but I didn't listen to the album much. Listening to it now, I'm realizing how much it sounds like Our Lady Peace. Same producer, same drum sound, and same guitar tones. Singer even sounds like Raine Maida on songs like Tip and Awake and Dreaming. But that said, I'm really enjoying this now. We're the album. Keith Preston said, overall, I'd like to say I like this album. The first four tracks have virtually no identity. However, very drony and samey. Then Above kicks in and the drummer remembers how to lock in groove and the guitars get spiky. You can start to see glimpses of the groove metal they made that made Therapy and Paralyzer such great songs. This is clearly a band trying to find itself. There's a lot of Verve Pipe and Tool influences all over this thing, but if you get past the first four songs, which aren't bad, just kind of lacking an identity, there's a worthy album here. Jason W. said, this album, although the music could be considered Quicksand, Orange, 9mm adjacent, it's missing the certain attitude of those bands. I like the sound usually, but the band just gets stuck in a rut and stays there, making it hard for me to cue on. Richard Waterman said, worthy album. The song Above has a killer chorus. Quicksand, Tip, and Awake and Dreaming are standouts too. It's got a post-grunge new metal sound. The snare is dangerously close to the St. Anger snare sound. There was a 97 Mercury and a 98 Windup release. Thanks, Wikipedia. Keep on rocking. Ian McIver, a fellow Canadian. CanCon Rules made the singles from the following albums playlist staples for the rock and alternative radio stations in the 2000s. And did nothing to make me give Finger Levin a second thought. The album quickly drops off the lead track. No wonder Quicksand was the lead single and track. It sounds like an album from the late 90s. Comes as no surprise. The band was dropped by the label when the initial response was tepid. Decent single. Of course, I could have told you Ian was going to give this a decent single. I would have bet sum of money on that. Like a big amount of money. This is why we're entering into a DraftKings. We're going to have an Ian specific parlay each week where depending on if he goes worthy album, better EP or decent single, if you parlay that with our picks, you can win a hat. So not actually going to win the hat. So mixed reviews. I'm curious to see how the poll is going to bounce. Or shape up at the end of this. But Jay, let's get into the record. I kept wanting to call this band Fingertip, but I'm not going to call them Fingertip. tell me one thing that worked from the album Tip by Finger 11.
First, I'm going to tell you some more word number bands, but okay. I can't believe you missed.
Okay, who did I miss?
Matchbox 20.
Yeah.
Sum 41. Blink 182. Maroon 5. Eve 6. Jurassic 5. Come on.
Is there one for each number? Like, is there a 1, a 2, and a 3, a 4, or a 5? Could you make a whole band or lineup of just number bands?
There's not a lot of 1s and 2s.
9-inch nails.
These were all just one name and one number. Or one name and a number. There were other. There's like 7, Mary 3, which is two numbers and a name. Or word.
Yeah,
I was trying to stick to the Finger 11 format. Okay, so what worked? Well, I'm going to double down on the sound. It's a really tight percussive sound. There's obviously the touching on sort of the overall mix here. You've got a snare that's a snare that's pretty high, but you know, overall drum kit I think is well mixed. It's not like overly tinny or annoying. But yeah, that snare is pretty high. And then that's offset with, which was common in the early 2000s for sure, which this band is a little bit ahead of, is to have these big dual rectifier guitar tones. It was Mesa Boogie. I'm assuming that's what they're using. So you get a ton of low end, which fills in that, you know, range between the snare and the guitars. And it creates a really... especially those guitar tones. I mean, they're very accessible, very appealing, almost syrupy, like corn syrup. I mean, it's like, it all's like compressed and everything rings out beautifully and it's very controlled. And I think they use that to their advantage quite often on this record by creating these rhythms that are punchy and very dynamic and rhythmic and crisp. They do a lot of like loud, quiet, but they even do it not just within like, okay, the verse is going to be quiet and the chorus is loud. Even within a riff, they will do a lot of palm muting and, you know, muting the cymbals so that you get these like dramatic stops and then loud parts even within the same riff. So I think that's just fundamentally what this, to me, what the sound of this band is. And then over top of that, you've got a singer that I would say spans sounding like Maynard on one end of the spectrum on the, some of the quiet stuff, to obviously Raine Maida on the other side. So within that, you get a pretty expressive vocal. He's got good range. He can do the, you know, the quiet, intense stuff. He can do the over-the-top, exuberant Raine Maida style stuff. Somewhere in the middle, he finds his own voice. But just to illustrate the sort of diversity here, you have. And then there's some surprises in here in terms of that I enjoyed wrapped around these, you know, fairly straightforward modern rock songs. There's some guitars that have some cool effects going on that really, I think, popped for me. So they're on the leads. So, you know, you have these big, thick rhythms, guitars, but then on top, there's a couple points in this record where they drop in a lead that's got a really interesting effect on it. So Wake and Dreaming is one example. Above has one. Even the end of the song Shudder, there's another one. There's like pitch shifting or gurgling sounds or like weird kind of not classic rock, but more I guess digital sounding or more late 90s, early 2000s sounding guitar effects, which is, I think, actually works pretty well. Creates a movement, kind of gets you out of that staccato rhythm stuff. And just, you know, has something else going on besides those big guitars and the vocal. So I thought that worked pretty well too. So that's some of the stuff that worked for me. How about you, Tim?
Well, I think the people in the comments hit on, and you did as well, that this sort of hits in a nice space between, I would say, like clumsy era Our Lady Peace. And I don't get the Tool. I get more like a Perfect Circle in terms of Maynard's, like a little bit more straightforward. Tool is such a specific thing. You're not getting Danny Carey's drumming with this.
No, vocally.
You're getting the more commercial end of Maynard, which is the Perfect Circle end. And you're right, like the guitars, or I'm going to say Keith, who mentioned that the first four songs kind of are okay, and then it sort of picks up with Above. That's where my ears perked up, is with Above. And when, first of all, there were some really nice dynamics in that song where they dropped out. And then the guitar solo part is really weird and nasty. And I was like, oh, cool. This isn't as pristine as the rest of the recording. Like it's got some flavor. It almost reminded me in some ways of Failure in just in terms of the way that they layer those like big drop D riffs and create just like enormity without sounding like metal. It's just big and heavy. But then they can drop down into something very small, very quickly. And I think for the most part, it was the guitars that I was locked into, because his vocal is, it's almost familiar because of the fact that he's in that space between Raine Maida and Maynard James Keenan, that I was like, oh, okay, I kind of know what this guy's doing. It's not a shock in any way. So just hearing the guitars, and this was, I feel like this was this sort of bridge between the 90s alternative hard rock sound and then the really overly processed 2000 sound, like where you get bands that just sound like they're, everything is completely digital and there's no life in the, there's no hiss. There's no, you know, amp buzz. There's nothing happening that isn't perfectly crafted in the studio. And this is sort of like just before that, where these are really, really well recorded guitars. And like you said, Jay, like I would not be surprised if these are Mesa Boogie rectifiers, and which was a very in vogue amp. a lot of people were playing those at this time. And it just has that like fat, wide sound with a lot of thickness. And I'm going to guess that there's probably a PRS involved too. That would be my guess for the guitar.
That was also that was the
choice guitar, because you weren't going to play a Les Paul, because that was like, oh, Slash plays a Les Paul. I'm in an alternative band. I'm going to play a Paul Reed Smith. And so I'm guessing that's just out on a limb that that's the combo, but it works. The songs are heavy, and I was really shocked at how condensed all these songs are. Like, there is not a single song over 5 minutes. Most of these are in the 3.5 minute range. Like, they were very conscious about, let's keep these things tight, let's not overindulge. And I think that's good, because I think if these songs went on for four and a half, 5.5, 6.5 minutes, the perfection would get, it would be too much. This is a 41 minute record, which is kind of shocking for 1997. I am shocked that this isn't 55, 60 minutes like most bands would have been indulging. And the fact that they kept it tight, I think, works to their advantage to keep these songs interesting. And again, like, you know, I mentioned above, that's only 343, and then the next song is 308 and 326. I mean, these are, you get through these songs quick, and you get to the next one, and it's, there's always a little flavor with regards to who was the lead player. I forgot which one it was, the lead guitarist.
Rick Jacket.
Like, he really does some interesting leads. He kind of reminds me of the guy from Our Lady Peace in that way. Well, the guy who got fired. What was it? Mike Turner.
Mike Turner, yeah.
Yeah, where you're in this very straightforward rock band, really, but then there's these really noisy and sort of counterintuitive sounds that are not as clean and not as as fine-tuned as the overall sound of the record. So that's some of the stuff that worked for me. Darren, what worked for you on this record?
I agree with a lot of what you guys said already, and some of the comments in the poll. I like that it's, the vocals are pretty present on the album. I like that you can hear them, and his voice is very strong, so I really like that. I mean, that's a lot of stuff from the 90s. A lot of vocals got buried, or the mix was so muddy, or it was just intentionally like wall of soundish or shoegaze-ish that it, you know, buried the vocals. And I like his vocals a lot. I like the mix on the album. I like the fact that the album's concise, and I think there's such power in the economy of the playing. Like, you have to remember, these guys were like, what, between 19 and 21 when this album was put out, when they created it. And I mean, I think there's a lot of restraint here, and I really respect that. And it's still pretty dense. Like, it's heavy, but it's not metal, and it's not, I don't know. I like a lot of that about it. I just think there's a lot of musical maturity here for where they're at in their careers. And I don't know. Some of the comments said something about grunge and whatever, and I don't hear grunge at all on this album. To me, it sounds more like Helmet or Quicksand, or that's kind of what I heard with better vocals, obviously, but that's kind of what I'm getting out of it more. And it's like you said, Jay, it's punchy, it's staccato, but I don't know. I think there's great rhythm. I don't think they overindulge. I don't think there's wasted notes really either. I respect all of that. And it's so tight. It's such a tight album. And there's only really two songs I don't really care for. So overall, it's, you know, pretty solid to me.
Jay, what doesn't work for you on the record?
Well, I mentioned how much I liked, you know, a couple of the guitar leads that popped. I wish that there was more of it. You know, there's too much for me, for my taste, for what this band is doing. There's too much of both guitars playing the same exact thing. Like, I would need a little more flavor there. I would love to hear some. Just more lead, even just playing the chords different, like phrasing them different, mm-hmm. or playing an octave higher or lower, or more leads. Like, a lot of these songs, just I want like some kind of melodic hook, you know, from the guitar, and it's like right into the riff and the rhythm, and then I don't know, it's missing like a dynamic for me to put it over the top, and I think really distinguish it. Without that element, then it's almost so straightforward. It just comes down to the songs for me. And I agree that there were some comments that, to me, the record doesn't really make sense until I get to Above. I think Awakened Dreaming is caught my attention just because it's just a change of pace. You know, things quiet down. There's some strings mixed in there. The vocal, you see a different side of him. It doesn't follow the quiet verse, loud chorus so predictably. It's a little different structure. But then Above, it finally has, I think, a hook that delivers. And that's where I started to like, okay, now I'm starting to get what this band is about. Once the hook started connecting, and it was really more on the second half, the particular, the middle of the record, and then a couple of tracks later, that it consistently was like delivering solid choruses that I didn't feel like were there at the beginning of the record. The beginning of the record was sort of like, I could hear the Helmet comparisons and the Quicksand comparisons, but then it didn't have quite the aggression and the, like, the weirdness of like a second weird guitar part or some kind of like, you know, over the top energy to make sense there. And then it also didn't have a hook, but then once I heard the hook, I was like, okay, now I get it. It's like trying to bring those heavier influences or rhythmically based influences and down tuning, but like still deliver a, you know, Our Lady Peace style, you know, hooky chorus. And I was like, okay, that makes sense to me. Like, I'm enjoying that. And I guess the last thing would just be like, you know, kind of like when The Voice was his own, you know, he, like I mentioned in the review, he does have some range, which is nice, but as I listened to the record more and more, I was sort of gravitating to those moments where, you know, he wasn't totally in the Maynard voice or totally in the Raine Maida voice. He was somewhere in the middle, and then I could figure out like who he was. That's more of a nitpick, but just something that came to mind. Anything not working for you, Tim?
Well, like I said, it doesn't really kick in for me until Above. just because, and I agree, like rhythmically, it's not as interesting above, and then Condenser have more interesting things happening. I want to talk about the last track, Swallowtail. That to me is a really interesting song because it has a nice long buildup. It has like a dramatic element to it. And there's a really nice effect on the guitar. It's giving this like modulated, you know, warble that just gives you a flavor that isn't on the rest of the record. I wish that they, I don't want the songs to necessarily be longer, but I just wish that they had played around a little bit more with, like you said, you have two guitars, take full advantage of that. You should not be locking into both playing the same chord progression the same time throughout most of the record. I needed a little bit more of the second guitar to be doing something original, like it does on that song and like it does on Above. And there's spots throughout the record, but they're just very minimal. And I just wanted a little bit more weirdness in just a few spots, just to create more like, oh, moments like, oh, that's cool. Like I need to go back and listen to that one again. I just was missing that. Like it's almost like, and I get it. This is like early and they don't hit their stride until, you know, three records down the road when they start to get some real success. So what you're hearing is essentially a group of teenagers or guys in their very early 20s, you know, adapting to a new, again, and also this is not this is a new sound for them. This is not what their last record sounded like. So they're figuring it out. And I can hear the DNA of something that's going to be very interesting. And, you know, I can hear the elements that people have mentioned, like, oh, that guitar riff, there's a big heavy guitar riff kind of sounds like Helmet, or there's something kind of like snaky happening that reminds me of Quicksand, where they do some stuff that's a little bit different rhythmically. And it just wasn't enough. I just wanted a little bit more. I was just like left desiring a little bit more from them. So it's not even like necessarily in terms of the back, I like the, like you said, the middle and the sort of couple songs in the back half. So it's not like there's terrible songs. It's just, I just wanted a little bit more out of the tracks that were a little bit bland. So Darren, you mentioned that there were a couple songs that don't work. What in general, what doesn't work for you, if anything?
Yeah, there's definitely some things that don't work for me. I would say what I don't like are some of the tones tend to start sounding the same. Some of the tempos are very similar. And then the mood of the album, I find I got to be in the right mood to listen to this record. And it kind of gets a little pummeling after a while. So again, that to me, I lump that into what mood am I in? Like, am I going to the gym and am I throwing this on? Or am I trying to chill out? Because I'm trying to chill out. I'm probably not throwing this album on. So, you know, I don't know. I guess you could say they probably should have taken a few more risks here and there. Some of the songs do sound kind of similar in the beginning, but I feel like each song on the track listing is kind of a build up to, you know, a little bit different. And then you hit Above, and I don't know. I don't have too much negative to say about this album, to be honest.
Got it. Well, we talked about where this album or how this album did. It actually fared pretty well, not just in Canada, but it did have some success. Or not this album, but this band had some success in the the US. I can understand, though, this album having a tougher time in the US, but seeing potential in it. You know, if I wind up records and this band gets dropped, I'm going to go, oh, yeah, these guys have got some chops. If we can just get them in, you know, out on the road, get them touring with some bands like a Creed or Fuel or whoever's big at this time, and can get them some experience and then get them back in the studio, they can turn into something. And apparently that's what Wind Up thought, because they ended up striking, you know, gold, I guess, down the road with this band. So, but I can understand that 98, man, you got to have a really good hook to get on the radio at this point. And I don't think any of these songs have particularly, like, there's no arms wide open. There's no like big blatant song that's the radio song to me. What about you, Jay?
Above was the hooky one here in Canada. Like, it got a big video, and it got quite a bit of radio airplay. It was the one they kind of like tried to really, you know, catch on with.
Yep.
Right.
That makes sense. Yeah, there's no arms wide open like crossover hit on here, but there's definitely a couple songs that you could easily have heard on, you know, modern rock radio at the time. In some ways, it sounds a little ahead of its time. I don't know. My memory might be fuzzy, but this sound in 97 would be pretty fresh. You know, it's not like this album came out in 2002.
Right.
You know, so what they're doing here, I need to look at some of the contemporaries again in 97, but this feels like it's maybe right on the edge, which
is
kind of cool.
97's OK Computer.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're still knee deep in 90s. This is Be Here Now. And
yeah.
You know,
Helmet Aftertaste, I think, came out this year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
97. Yeah.
And again, like, you listen to Helmet compared to this. Helmet, mm-hmm. like, is a punch in the face. Like, there is, it is a big, heavy assault. And this has some, like, texture almost to it, that or some, dare I say, groove that doesn't quite match up with that. And it's a harder sell, I think. Although Helmet wasn't getting on the radio by 97. I mean, let's be honest. No. Like,
well, and you said, Darren, this band was, the album before this was heavily funk influenced. So
very funk, sense. Like rock, funk metal, yeah. Funk. Alternative, I guess you could say, but yeah, it wears its funk influences on its sleeve for sure. If you happen to check it out, you'll recognize that right away.
But you can hear there's a sensibility here of like how to play with a groove. I mean, there's a lot of 6/8 and halftime stuff on here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things you're not going to hear like a Helmet play, which is going to be more of a jackhammer. This album has a little swing or groove to it.
For those that don't know, 6/8 means your beat is like a waltz. Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3. Just not everybody's plays guitar and has been in bands like we have. So as opposed to 4/4, which is 1, 2, 3, 4. Everybody knows 4/4.
Which is like AC/DC.
Which is like, yeah, every AC/DC song is in 4/4. I don't think they've ever used another time signature. And God bless them too, yeah. Because we don't need them to. God, if they came out and did a 6/8 song, I'd be like, what is going on? Is the world ending? Why is Angus playing in 6/8? No, I don't think Phil Rudd knows how to play in 6/8. Is he even still in the, he's not in the band anymore, is he?
No, he's not playing in the band right now.
Okay. Yeah. So.
Yeah. Slade's back in, I think now, isn't he?
Yeah.
No, oh. No, they've got another drummer. And Chris, is it Chaney from Jane's Addiction is playing bass.
No, who's playing drums for AC/DC?
I said they got a new drummer. I can't remember what his name is. And the bass player is Chris Chaney from Jane's Addiction.
The bass player is Chris Chaney?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
They just posted a new picture like 2 days ago of them rehearsing.
Is the new guitar player, the rhythm guitar player taking over from Malcolm, is that Dave Navarro? Okay, so let's
seem a little overkill for that to hire that bass player, but hey man, if he's grooving,
there's not enough notes for that guy. I mean, I need him to, he's going to play a low E for half the set. That's, you're not going to be doing a whole lot, but whatever. I guess if you get a chance to play with AC/DC, you're going to take it. Let's talk about our overall ratings for this record. Worthy album, better EP, decent single. I'll share the poll results from Patreon in just a moment, but Jay, where do you land on this?
I'm going to land on an EP. You know, I think this might be my bias, but one of my problems with this kind of big guitar tone is I think it might make bands a little become overly dependent on it. And that's what I'm hearing here. It's like, you just hit these big chords. You're like, oh my God, that's doing all the work. Like, all I need to do is just play this big G chord. And it's like, fills up the whole room and like, sounds huge. Like, why do I need to play something else? And I feel like there's a little bit of that going on in this record. It's almost too about the tone and the rhythm. And I just need a little bit more going on here melodically and from an energy standpoint. That said, I'm going to start with Awake and Dreaming, where to me the record kicks off. I think Above starts to really set the best example of what the band can do. Condenser, Thin Spirits is solid. I would skip Glimpse, and then I think it ends solid. You know, I'm with you on Swallowtail, Tim. It's actually that chorus almost approaches Creed-like, in that it's a little anthemic. You know, there's some nice movement with the guitar in that, and you can hear that kind of big soaring hook come out of that chorus. There's some nice road sounds on the guitars on that song too. It just has a different flavor to it. So I'm gonna land an EP. You know, I think I'm at about 6-7 songs here, so you know, it's a pretty solid EP for me. Where'd you land, Tim?
Well, before that, I did check and everything's half step down. So that makes sense. This is the sound of a band playing a half step down. They've definitely tuned down. I'm also at an EP, basically the same songs as well. I do like Glimpse. It just has that helmet thing going, like at the beginning of it sounds like it's off of Meantime. It's like, oh yeah, this is my kind of riff right here. Cause I love 90s Helmet. Except for Strap It On. The beginning of the record just doesn't. Now, maybe if it was reshuffled, maybe it would work better for me. Maybe if it opened with Above and then we move into other tracks and it was just a different track list, some of the things would pop better. But I'm more on the back end of this record and I'm in about 6 songs. So that's a better EP for me. Darren, where do you land?
We're the album. For the album, for sure. I would only skip 2 songs, probably Condenser and Temporary Arms, but that leaves 9 out of 11 tracks for me, so I'm going with Worthy Album for sure. And I can honestly say seeing them live, I saw them on the Greatest of Blue Skies tour, like the album right after this one, it breathed a whole new life into the songs off it. Like seeing it live, I can honestly say that they're more dynamic, there's more energy, there's more, like, there's just more for sure. So,
well, the Patreon community agrees with you. 63% went Worthy Album, 38% went Decent Single. Nobody agreed with us, Jay.
What the?
Not a single person in the union agreed with us. I don't think that's ever happened before. We're the outlier, completely all on our own on an island.
Huh.
I guess we're done.
Oh, shit.
We're done.
What do we know?
We don't know anything. It's all opinions. And the opinion on this one is we're the owned by the Patreon community. Better EPs for us. Go check it out. It's on all the streaming services. And as I believe all of their material is, you can listen to. I'm actually curious to hear that Paralyzer song. And like, maybe I heard it and I didn't realize it because it seems like I should have heard it. And I'm actually going to, I want to go to Spotify and see how many spins it has.
So I got the name of the drummer for AC/DC.
Jeez. What?
Matt Log.
Log?
L-A-U-G. He's been in play with Alice Cooper slash the Snake Pit, and he is the drummer on Alanis Morissette's Jagged Little Pill in 1995.
Isn't that Taylor Hawkins?
He did not
he
play
was in the touring band.
Oh, he's
he
in the touring band.
He was
in
the touring band for that album, yeah.
Okay.
So AC/DC currently has two members of Alanis Morissette's band.
Wow, because Chris Cheney
Chris
played
Cheney
the
was
bass.
The bass player, and
yeah.
Matt Logan was the studio what? Drummer.
Wow.
Isn't that ironic? All right, so on Spotify, Paralyzer has 343 million spins.
Wow.
And then the next closest song is One Thing with 49 million.
Yeah. Yeah, that one was on. One Thing was featured on Scrubs, Smallville, and Third Watch.
Oh.
And they performed it on Live in Regis and Kelly. They performed it live.
Well, that's going to put you over the top.
Dang.
Yeah, that was the album I checked out. Self-titled. That's when I kind of got off the bus at that point. So,
gotcha. Well, thank you for bringing this to us, because I feel like this sort of, it's not new metal, but it's adjacent, like Jay mentioned. Like, this is a blind spot for us. We have not really done a lot of that late 90s sound. So I'm glad we're able to get into it. The picture, I'm just looking at the picture on Spotify. It looks like it's a bunch of dudes, a couple guys with beards, a couple guys with, they're all wearing work shirts. And I'm like, is this a band, or are they like a craft brewery employee group? Or like, I'm not sure what's going on. Maybe they're the pit crew for a NASCAR team. Like, they're all wearing like overall, like full body, not bodysuit, but like work overalls.
Trying to give the impression of being a blue collar band, maybe at this
I guess
point
so.
In their career.
Yeah. From the home of Burlington Coat Factory come Finger 11. Thank you for bringing this to us.
Yeah, my pleasure.
And want to remind folks who are listening at home that you can suggest a record by joining the DMO Union at dmounion.com or digmeoutunion.com. It's where you can vote in the polls, just like for this episode. And you can vote in our monthly album selection polls, which are selected via our hopper that collects suggestions from our website, digmeoutpodcast.com. You can suggest albums for both our 90s rock podcast that you are currently listening to, or our 80s metal podcast, which we are hoping that you check out if you haven't already. It comes out every other week. It's with our friend Chip Midnight, and we talk about 80s metal bands. We just did a record called Malice. That was fun. We've talked Badlands. We've talked Faster Pussycat. We've talked Yngwie Malmsteen. I probably said that wrong. Yngwie or Yngwie? It's Yngwie, right? There's like an ing.
I don't know anymore.
I don't know. What's even real? I don't know. So that's where you can go to suggest records for either of the podcasts. It's also where you can sign up for the Box newsletter, which is the home of our 80s metal podcast. The Box newsletter on Substack, every week, a release calendar of new albums, books, documentaries. This year has been a plethora of 90s TV shows and documentaries and stuff. Lots of stuff has popped up this year. Last year was kind of dry, but this year there's been a number of things. The Lollapalooza documentary on Paramount Plus, you had the Bon Jovi documentary on Hulu. There was just a Duran Duran documentary that dropped on Netflix and some other stuff. I watched the Wham documentary on Netflix.
Okay.
Fascinating. I did not know the history of that band at all. It was truly fascinating.
I may have watched that now that I think of it.
Is
it new?
It came out either the end of last year or the beginning of this year. Yeah. And if you want to hear something that will make you cringe so much your back might snap, listen to the Wham rap song, which was the first single that Wham wrote. It is horrifying. I'm glad they were able to figure out how to write songs, because Wham rap is not good. I don't know. That was purely a UK sensation. I don't think that made any inroads in the United States. I hope not, or I would be ashamed of us. Lastly, Apple Podcasts is where you go to leave positive feedback for the show. For Jay, I'm Tim. We're out. and we'll be back next week with another episode of Dig Me Out.